know you're all waiting for an impressions video on the Anthem VIP demo, but I thought we need to deal with the real important questions first. It so happens that my wife is busy finishing her degree in astrophysics, so I showed this to her and her freakout was too memorable not to share. Allow me to introduce my wife, Annie.
Hello, hello.
Is this view possible in our solar system?
No.
Not at all. Like, not even planets with multiple moons.
Absolutely not. First of all, the relative sizes of those two planets are just, it's just wrong. They're way, way, way too large for it to be physically possible. And if, as the Anthem developers say, we are on a planet as well, then you've got a very complex four-body system going here. And either this planet and the moon, or that planet and the moon, are going to be completely shredded and torn apart. Probably what would happen is all three of them would end up crashing into each other and becoming one large mess.
It's not just that this is not possible in our solar system.
Here's the thing, right? If you ignore the fact that this view is taken from a planet, or it's claimed to, they claim that this view has been taken from a planet.
Well, I can tell you, I took this screenshot while standing on the planet.
Okay, but let's pretend that you are not standing on a planet, and okay, you are in fact only in a spaceship, which leaves you with just a planet and a moon, and then the sun, or the light source in this case.
The four-body system, right? So the star, the planet, and the moon, and then either us being another moon or a planet.
Yes. So at the moment, you've got a four-body system. But let's try to simplify it just a little bit and convert it to a three-body system. So let's ignore the planet that we're currently standing on.
Okay.
Right. Let's say we are actually looking out of the forward view screen of a spaceship of some sort.
Okay.
You still have a moon that is way too close to its parent planet. Even those two on their own would not be able to exist in those ratios.
Okay. Put this in perspective for me, because that kind of looked, at first glance, like a normal-sized moon to me. And then you just have this gigantic planet behind it, which I was obviously a little skeptical about.
Okay, so let's get technical for a second, right? When you come to measuring the size of planets, you talk about their arc length.
Okay.
Right, so the number of degrees of the sky that it takes up. Now, that's the only thing that we can look at in this case, because we don't know the actual sizes of these planetary bodies, and we also don't know how far away from us they are. So the only thing we can work with here is their relative scale sizes, the amount of sky that they're taking up.
Okay.
Right, so I asked you to get me the field of view of this particular image.
Yes, and so they don't have a field of view slider in the game yet. It's a massive point of contention, but it sounds like the horizontal field of view is about 80 degrees.
Okay. So if we work with 80 degrees horizontal field of view here, and the image you sent me is 1920 pixels wide.
Yep, good old 1080p, that's all I can afford.
At 1920 pixels and 80 degree field of view, the moon works out to be 11.06 degrees field of view in the sky.
Okay.
All right.
So how much does our moon take up?
Our moon is 0.5 of a degree in the sky.
So that's like a planet-sized thing, if it was as far away from us as the moon.
Yes. So I'll give you some relative scales in a moment, but also, again, using the 80-degree field of view and the 1920 pixels, that large moon was measured to be 1,050 pixels across, and that gives us a 43.3-degree field of view. Right? And that is massive. Some enterprising artist/scientist went ahead and did a series of images, of photographs, of what the other planets of our solar system would look like if they were at the same distance as the moon. To give you an idea, if Saturn was the same distance from us as the moon is, it would take up 18 degrees of the sky. Now, to remind you, the small planet, the moon, was 11 degrees, and Saturn is 18 degrees. The large one is currently taking up 43 degrees of the sky. If Jupiter was at the same distance as the moon, Jupiter would only take up 20 degrees of the sky.
And that's the biggest planet in the solar system. That's like the biggest object in our solar system other than the sun.
Yes.
Most people will understand that if you've got something that massive, that close to the Earth, the gravitational effects would be catastrophic. It would mess up the tides. And anybody who's played Anthem knows that it's very pretty. There's waterfalls, you can go swimming, and you make cute scuba noises.
If you're talking about disrupting the tides, I don't think you're getting quite the scale of what would happen in this instance. We're talking tectonic plates being ripped apart. and the entire planet essentially being turned into a giant molten ball. Just to make things even more interesting, if you were to pretend that the large planet was not there, right, let's just talk about that moon for a second. At lunar distance, Neptune is 7.5 degrees of the sky, and that thing is 11 degrees. So that thing is larger than Neptune. That in itself will have a gravity well that will cause incredibly detrimental effects to life on whatever this planet is called.
So next question. Let's assume this thing is actually even more massive than Jupiter. It's just really, it's just not as close as the moon. It's much further away.
Okay. So what you're trying to say is we're talking about the large planet.
Yes.
So the large planet is actually really, really far away. It's just massive,
right,
which is why it takes up so much of the sky.
Right. And so like the next thing I immediately think of is that Jupiter was like almost the sun.
Yes.
Right. And so at what point does Jupiter become massive enough to become a sun?
Okay. The smallest red dwarf star we know of is 80 times the mass of Jupiter. Not the size necessarily. Now, if we can find 79 more Jupiters and crash them into Jupiter, we can turn it into a second star.
Okay, so let's take Jupiter. We inflate it 79 times. I mean, it's a very simplistic thought experiment, but just for the sake of scale and argument, let's take Jupiter. We multiply it by 79, and how far away does that put it from the planet I'm standing on?
We take Jupiter, right? And Jupiter's diameter is like 140,000 kilometers, roughly, just under. And so we multiply that by 79, then we get like 14.5 million. Kilometers diameter. If we wanted Jupiter to take up the same amount of sky as this large planet is taking up, it would be 11 million and change kilometers away.
That's not that far away.
So 11 million kilometers is not actually all that far. In fact, 11 million kilometers is only 0.09 of an AU. Right, and now an AU is an astronomical unit.
It's 0.1 if you round up.
Okay, so I'll give you that, right? So it'll be 0.1 of an AU from this planet.
And AU is the length, is the distance between us and the sun.
Yes. So this thing would literally be 10% of the way between the sun and the earth.
And what's the distance from between us and, say, Mars?
So Mars is 1.5 AU. So it is half an AU away from us. It's 1.5 AU from the sun.
And Venus?
Venus is 0.72 AU from the sun. So it is like 0.28 AU away from us. So Venus is 0.28 AU away from us. If Jupiter, if this planet was like 80 times Jupiter, it would be closer to us than what Venus is to us. What you need to understand here is we're talking about turning Jupiter into another sun, essentially.
Almost.
Right? Almost into another sun. 79 times the mass of Jupiter, just not 80. So it's like nearly a sun, nearly a star. You have to understand that Mercury is 0.4 AU from the sun. And we would be 0.1 AU from this thing that is almost a sun. And Mercury is really, really inhospitable.
Sure, but Jupiter wouldn't quite be a sun, right?
It would give off incredible amounts of radiation. The same guy who did the series of artworks of what the other planets would look like in the sky if they were the same distance as the moon, he did one of Jupiter. What they said is if it was actually the situation, all life on our planet would be dead because Jupiter gives off incredible amounts of radiation.
So, like, one Jupiter gives off enough radiation to kill us all?
Yes.
So 79 of them, just super dead.
So I think what will happen is the first thing you've got to look at is the gravity well, right? So if we were that close to it, it would just suck us in. And what's to say that that last little bit of mass it gathers from our planet isn't enough to push it over the edge and make it collapse in on itself and turn into a small red dwarf?
Well, we would have to be the last Jupiter that gets fed in.
True. But there are stellar objects that are smaller than the red dwarf star. They have a lower mass. They're called the brown dwarf. It's not really entirely a star.
So the next thing that interested me was the shape of the light on these planets.
When I look at the light situation of these planets, there's two things that I can think of might be happening. First scenario is that there is the single sun that the system has, and it is kind of to our left and to the front a little bit, maybe like a 45 degree angle, because we can see about a quarter of the moon's surface. And also similarly, you can see we've got a very small crescent of the large planet. Either the sun is to the front and to the left of us, or the other thing could be happening is that the sun is actually behind the planet that we are allegedly on, or the alleged planet that we are on. And those crescents are, the shadow parts are caused by our planet blocking out the light. So that is the shadow of our planet that is causing those crescents. Now, first scenario, with the sun being to the left and to the front, you would not be able to see all those stars. That makes me think that the second scenario is the more likely one. Now, in the first situation, if the sun were off to the side, we would not be able to see a crescent moon shape like that. Because a crescent moon shape like that only occurs on the light side of the Earth. Because of the way the sun and the Earth and everything moves and the moon moves around us, the waxing and the waning of the moon and its different phases, you usually see crescent moon and no moon during daylight hours, and you will see the sort of three-quarter and full moon during nighttime hours. In this situation, it doesn't make sense. It's not the right geometry for the sun to be located to the front and to the left of us. So the second scenario is more likely, that the sun is actually behind us, and we are casting a shadow onto these planets. But if you look at the shadows, the shape of the shadows on these two planets, they're wrong. First of all, if you look at the moon, the crescent is symmetrical. If you look at the planet also seems to be rather symmetrical, but we can't see the bottom half of the planet. That symmetry would only be present on both bodies if they were perfectly aligned. In other words, the moon is either too high or the planet is too low in the sky for this particular shadow geometry to take place.
Mm.
And secondly, if you look at the size of the shadows on the large planet and on the moon, that tells me if the sun is behind us and that's our shadow, the alleged planet that we are standing on has to be massive in order to cast that sort of shadow on these planets.
Which leads us back to our previous argument about mass, right?
Well, it leads us back to the three or the four body gravity problem, which is that we have a massive gravity well, that large planet has a massive gravity, that moon on its own has a fairly significant gravity well. Really, this view would probably exist for only, I don't know, a couple of hours before everything just kind of crashes into one another.
During the daylight hours, the planets completely disappear.
Okay, so the only way that you would not be able to see them in the day sky is if they were tidally locked to the night side of the planet that you are on. Which means that as you are going around the sun, they stay behind you the whole time. And that means that these relative positions stay fixed all the time. That moon is always going to be a little bit, you know, up and to the left, and the planet's always going to sit at that angle with so much of it visible above the horizon. That just breaks any potential physics of these three bodies not just being crushed into one another.
The question then is, if not possible in this solar system or even this universe, then where are we?
Quite possibly you might just be on the Truman Show. And these are, you know, planet pictures that have been painted up against the sky. Because if these bodies were actually rotating, whether you're rotating around them or they're rotating around you, doesn't matter. Either way, you would be able to see these two bodies in daylight. Even if our original assumption about the field of view was wrong, right? Maybe this isn't an 80 degree field of view. Maybe we're dealing with something smaller, like the typical field of view from a camera is more like 55 degrees. That moon is still 7.7 degrees in the sky, and the planet is still 30 degrees in the sky. And those are just still too large for it to be physically possible.
Mm. So at what point does the big planet become what the size of Jupiter would be in our sky?
This field of view that we have here would have to be 36.5 degrees. And that is very, very tiny.
I think people were moaning about the field of view now. Reduce it to 37 degrees and see what happens.
Of course, the larger the field of view gets, the worse the scenario is.
Yeah, so if I made a mistake and the field of view is not 80 but 90.
90 or 100 or 110, the larger the field of view becomes, the larger the angular size of these planets, the more messed up this system is and the worse the situation is, and the sooner death will be upon you all.
So you're saying we have more than the Dominion to worry about?
I don't know who that is, so...
Good morning!
Morning!
Good morning!
Oh, and in case I don't see you, good afternoon, good evening, and good night.